Welcome to the Harpe Bioherbicide Podcast. I'm Dr. Alex Danis, and today we're talking with Director and COO of Harpe Bioherbicide, Daniel Pepitone. A Brooklyn native who first spent time as a livestock producer on his family's farm in Israel, Daniel has over 15 years of experience in agricultural product development. He's a staunch advocate for farmers and has been behind the marketing and global launch of numerous active ingredient herbicide molecules. In our conversation, Daniel delves into how Harpe's innovative approach is finally solving long-standing problems that have hindered big agriculture for decades.
Well, thank you so much for joining us. Who are you? What do you do?
Sure. No, really appreciate being here today. We're at our field site here in North Carolina. My name is Daniel Pepitone. I'm one of the founders, chief operating officer of Harpe Bioherbicide Solutions.
And yeah, tell me more about where we are. What are we doing out here today?
So we're at one of our research stations that we utilize through NC State here in Rocky Mount, North Carolina. So a little bit towards the northeastern side of beautiful farming country of North Carolina.
It is, in fact, absolutely gorgeous out here today. So tell me a little bit, you know, we're here because we're talking about Harpe. We're talking about herbicides. Tell me the beginning of Harpe. Where did this idea really come from?
So the idea truly originated with my partner, founder, Dr. Chad Bromer. Him really sitting down one day and really thinking about what can be done, you know, based on his background, all the work that he's done to develop a herbicide, but develop one using the compounds that are found in nature. So he's was able to really, you know, pencil out, if you will, what that possibly could be, then take some steps at working in his house, in his kitchen, with his oyster blender, which will bronze someday, and developing some formulations that, you know, completely out of control in terms of price and the amount we needed, but it was the proof of concept that really said, hey, there is something here that is a herbicide, it's natural, kills weeds, and off it went.
And so we've gone from that blender in his kitchen to now being out here in a field where we can see the results of this product. What has that journey looked like of getting from the blender to here?
Yeah, it's been a fantastic roller coaster ride, as it should be. Really taking some what has turned out to be monumental steps to get us to a place where we have chemistry in our hand that if we walk out into the field, really seeing the power of what nature can do. So taking these compounds, turning them into formulations. You know, the first time, and we see it here today, but the first time we saw glyphosate-resistant Palmer amaranth die and not be killed by glyphosate alone is fascinating and, you know, jump up and down excitement. But it's, you know, it's those series of steps that have taken along the way to get us here. Range of work that was done, amazing steps over a 3+ year period to get us to where we are, and that's a full portfolio of herbicides, pre, post, burn down. It's great.
And yeah, so you're talking about some of these different steps, some of these different milestones that you all have hit. What's it been a really exciting recent one that you've been like, hey, we've hit this new thing, we had these goals and we got to them?
Yeah, we really look at three key factors, and that's how much active ingredients do we need to use, how much water, and what kind of volume are we talking about, and then also key driver is a price point. So the successive steps of innovation have continually allowed those to come down, meaning we're using the amount of chemistry that a farmer looks at and goes, hey, it's very comparable to what I use today on my farm. We're not asking them to spray at 50, 100 gallons per acre. We're actually down that 10, 15, 20 range, depending on the application. And quite honestly, we went from $1,000+ per acre application down to a comparative price point to where a farmer looks at today. So it's those getting it to where it fits into what we know as farming today on a wide scale to be able to fit those products in and not having to make a farmer do something different or bust a budget or you know, they're businessmen. They need to be profitable.
And yeah, tell me a little bit more about that. Why is it so important that this fits into what they're already doing?
Yeah, it needs to fit into what they're doing because they're farming. They have one of the hardest jobs, if not the hardest job on earth, and they're feeding our families, they're feeding people on a global scale, and we can't ask them to do something dramatically different to use our product. That's just not going to work. At the same time, our products need to provide a new solution that does something that their current products may have did in the past or didn't do at all. We think about that in terms of weed control. You know, there's a bunch of weeds that farmers just can't control anymore with the chemistry they have today. They once worked, they don't anymore. Add Harpe to the mix, new mode of action chemistry, works on its own, as well as in combination to overcome, fill some of those gaps, those challenges that farmers are facing.
And why have those gaps persisted over time? You know, you guys are coming in, you've got this new solution. Why you? Why now? Why have you been able to fill in this gap that other people weren't able to?
You know, that's a wonderful question. I'm not sure if I can fully answer that.
Okay.
Other than, you know, we take a different approach. Our approach from the beginning was, we're not looking for the next synthetic molecule. We're actually looking for something that's not that. You know, there's wonderful innovation being done every day by each of the crop input companies on, you know, their focus is synthetic chemistry. They're starting to switch over, knowing that the needs are to get to a more natural biological state. But that was Chad's focus from the beginning. How do I tap into something that's natural and go from there versus switching into doing something else? You know, his history, what he did throughout his career in terms of his educational side through Mississippi State, working with natural products, you know, 20 years ago, is brought forward today.
And why is it so important that this is a natural solution, or why did you look to natural options for this to be the solution?
It's what's being asked of agriculture. Agriculture, you know, is continuous. It has changed over time. For the last 50-100 years, we've moved from just machinery now to chemical, you know, ways to control weeds. We're taking the next steps. So we're taking the next steps of that evolution into a biological, into a natural product for weed control. Again, that's what's being asked of agriculture. Earth is asking for different things. It's clearly proven. You know, we talk about climate control all we want. Those kinds of things taking place, we've got to do different. Consumers are asking for different. They have a lot of questions about their food system. They get access to a whole lot more information than they ever have in the past, asking different questions, wanting different things. We need to answer those things. That spills over into regulatory. Regulatory is saying, hang on a second, we need to do different. If we look at Europe, they've demanded a 50% reduction in synthetic pesticides in the next decade. We don't have a lot of time.
Yeah.
Not to meet those demands.
And I've heard you talk before a little bit about other places where the kinds of extracts you're using are used. How do we know that these things are safe, that they're going to meet these sort of increased regulatory questions about safety, about environmental concerns?
Sure. All of the natural active ingredients that we utilize come from mainly mint plants, different compounds that are found in there. All of those are already have been reviewed by the EPA and are considered minimum risk. In fact, if we take our fully organic natural pesticide herbicide formulations, we could actually walk out into the market today, get the state registrations, not have to get any other FIFRA EPA review, and we can start selling those products. These products are incredibly well known. They're used in everyday products that we consume: mouthwash, gums, shampoos, medicinal purposes. So they're an incredible amount of information is known about them to, you know, consider them what they are, and that's generally considered safe. What I think is also pretty amazing is that, you know, we walk out into the field, you'll see the field signs on the plots and says we're using an Arbensis formulation. That's a kind of mint. That mint generally comes from India. So we can actually think about that formulation and take the steps backwards. That formulation, using the mint extract that's in there, was grown on a field in India by a small shareholder farmer. So we're just thinking about some of the other aspects of what goes into, you know, making a formulation, a herbicide, more sustainable for this planet.
Yeah, tell me a little bit more about that too, because this has impacts not just with the farmers who are going to actually be using the product, but also the farmers who are going to be growing the product. So tell me more about that.
Yeah, we can think about it, you know, kind of a circular economy, if you will. There are about 2 million small shareholder farmers that grow mint in northern India. You go to New Delhi, east of that. You know, it's a tremendous actual marketplace that's there. We got to spend a couple of weeks investigating the supply chain, really understanding what takes place, how they get oil from the field all the way to what's used here. It's a wonderful sustainability story. It's a wonderful way to think about what can be done, supporting farmers on a local level, you know, improving their quality of life while tapping into nature, building herbicides that can then be applied to a field and really kind of close that loop. It's exciting to think about, you know, that the products we're using in a field here in North Carolina can be directly traced back to a field in northern India where that farmer grew that mint plant first.
What are the biggest remaining challenges to making this whole system work, to getting from that farmer in India all the way out to the things that people are using in the field here?
Yeah, the system itself is in place from the supply chain. We work with a bunch of wonderful people that really understand supply chain. That's what they've done throughout their careers. And that part is built out. We also be lucky enough, one of our lead investors is ADM. They're one of the largest suppliers of mint plant extracts on a global scale. So a lot of great people that we work with on that kind of overview from that side. So that challenge is kind of ready to go. The next challenges are really getting the formulations to where they're commercially done, viable, set to be sprayed in a commercial setting. We're close. We've got to, Chad and his team have a bit more work to do, but we're getting there. And, it's fantastic to see, again, those progressions to get us to that place where, hey, we've got the finished goods in our hands.
What are the biggest criticisms that people pose to Harpe, and how do you respond to those criticisms?
Yeah, I mean, criticism and the critiques come in different ways. I think it's less about critiques, more about believability. Right? Everything that we're doing today, everything that we're putting our hands on, that we're spraying in the field, has never been done before ever, which is wild to think about. So there's that aspect of believability, because unfortunately some of the products that came beforehand didn't perform the way they should, didn't cost right, the outcomes weren't there necessarily. So there's doubt. The other side of it is, and you asked the question earlier, why us, right? And that's some of the criticisms that we get as well. It's hard to answer that question other than, well, we're doing it. And we're proving it every day in the field. Is this product perfect? No, but I don't think that was ever the goal. It's going to get to a place where it's commercial ready, where it can be sprayed alone, it can be sprayed in combination. It's going to solve some of the problems that farmers face, especially when we think about weed control and what's just not working in their field. So we get a bunch of criticism, we get a bunch of non-believers, and that's okay. Not every customer is our customer, so we're good with it.
I think that's a perfect answer. You get these field trials going, you're testing out the product. Where do you see it in 5 years? What do you hope for the future of getting this out there?
Yeah, it's a great, because we think about that vision, and we thought about that vision from the very beginning. And we've made a couple of conscious decisions as a business. Our intent is never to commercialize this ourselves. The amount of time, effort, money, all the wonderful things that it would take to do that, I don't want to say are out of our reach, but a bit more challenging than what we've done today. And we know what we're good at and what we're not as well, right? We're real good at being quick, being nimble, making pivots as we need to develop a product that's our strong suit, or develop a portfolio of products, and that's what we're doing. Our goal is, the next steps is really to divest. There are some really wonderful companies that have built out all the infrastructure, have built out the marketing, the relationships with distribution, all the other pieces that need to go into place so that farmers can reach the solution as quickly as possible. So divesting this technology, all the IP that goes with it, to another company that can then take those next steps and see it successfully in the marketplace.
And then what for you? Harpe goes out, it's getting out to farms, then what do you do?
Yeah, we're already thinking about the next. There's a whole lot more that is potentially coming out of what Chad has written down in his idea notebook. and there's a whole lot to do, and that's exciting to think about what we can do from there. I think really more than anything, we're focused on what needs to get done over the next 6-12 months, whatever it may be, to before we kind of pivot again and do something different. Let's really focus. We've got a wonderful team working on a lot of wonderful things, whether it's in the office, in the field, in the labs. Focus on those things, reach the goals that we set out, and I think we'll all be really, really happy about it when it's said and done. Big achievements.
Yeah, I mean, things are going well. I got two final questions for you. First, what is the most exciting part of this for you? What keeps you up at night and getting up in the morning to be like, this is what we're doing?
Yeah, I mean, it's always been, we want to help farmers. We want to support farmers. I think you look at our backgrounds, whether it's myself, Chad, or or Bill Buckner, our CEO, you look at the backgrounds, or anybody on our team really, we've been in agriculture. We understand how hard it is for farmers each and every day. You know, we love eating food, right? People enjoy that on a global scale, need to eat, supporting them, because again, they do one of the hardest jobs ever, certainly one of the most important. And so having that focus has always been about the customer, about that end user farmer. And that's what makes it so incredible to see us be able to kill weeds that they can't today or they struggle with today, and do it in a better way, in a more sustainable way, using natural products. That's always been the core focus, hasn't changed.
And really, that leads into my last question perfectly. How do you reach those people? How do you say to them, this is, you know, it's hard to change up what you're doing on your farm. It's hard and it's scary to make those investments. We think it's worth it to change this product.
Yeah, and I think that's part of the business thesis as well, in terms of it's not going to be, you know, Harpe, this tiny company, startup company that doesn't have the believability factor already built in. So we think about the large companies, they have these wonderful relationships, trusted advisors to these growers already, whether it be chemicals or seeds or otherwise. They're beginning to make those changes into more natural products, biological products. We see them doing that. We see grower adoption taking place. In order for that grower adoption to take place, or any type of adoption, you have to have that believability. Those companies come with it versus us trying to build that up in the marketplace. Again, that we think that's how we get these solutions to the farmer that much faster.
That's fantastic. Anything I haven't asked you, anything you want to talk about that I haven't given you the opportunity to?
I don't think so.
All right, fantastic. Well, thank you for joining me.
Thank you so much. Really appreciate it.
This wraps up this episode of the Harpe Bioherbicide Podcast. Huge thank yous to Daniel Pepitone and, of course, to our listeners and viewers. For more information on today's topic and on Harpe Bioherbicide's mission to provide a new sustainable approach to weed control, please visit harpebio.com. Thanks for listening, and we'll see you next time.